Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Good Friday, April 14th, 2017. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Easter Sunday, our services are at 8 o'clock and 10:30. We're serving Easter breakfast from 8:30 to 10.
Let us pray. Almighty God, look with loving mercy on your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and to be given over to the hands of sinners and to suffer death on the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Thank you.
Diane Myers will be doing the reading.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 52 and 53. Saying, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marvelous his appearance beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which had not been told them, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of all of us. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done with violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We will now sing verse 1 of hymn 359, where charity and love prevail. 359.
By the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he has promised. For he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We're singing the Lenten Gospel Acclamation. Our pastor, Pastor Pollock, will be reading the Gospel. We have just sung a 9th century Latin hymn as the psalmody. Welcome to Good Friday service, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, commemorating Jesus' death. His soul has gone to be with God, as he has said, God, receive my spirit, into your hands I commend my spirit, and his body, his lifeless body, is in the tomb. Receive his resurrected body.
The Passion of the Lord according to St. Matthew. You may be seated until we come to the 45th verse, and I will ask you to stand, which will begin with darkness covered with light. The Passion of the Lord. When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate the governor. When Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. He said, I have sinned by betraying innocent blood. But they said, what is that to us? See to it yourself. Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed, and he went and hanged himself. Chief priests, taking the pieces of silver, said, it is not lawful to put them into the treasury, since they are blood money. After conferring together, they used them to buy the potter's field as a place to bury foreigners. For this reason, that field has been called the field of blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of the one on whom a price had been set, on whom some of the people of Israel had set a price, and they gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord commanded. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, are you the king of the Jews? Jesus said, you say so. But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him, do you not hear how many accusations they make against you? No answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone who they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas, or Jesus, who is called the Messiah? For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him. Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them, which of the two do you want me to release for you? And they said, Barabbas. Pilate said to them, then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah? All of them said, let him be crucified. Then he asked, why? What evil has he done? But they shouted all the more, let him be crucified. So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather than arrive at his beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourself. People as a whole answer, his blood be on us and on our children. So he released Barabbas, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They spat on him, took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him, and they led him away to crucify him. As he went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they offered him wine and drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now if he wants to. For he said, 'I am God's son.'" The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. Those who came released him. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "This man is calling for Elijah." At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it him to drink. But the others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him." Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said, "Truly, this man was God's son." The passion of our Lord. May be seated as we sing hymn number 351, "O Sacred Head, Now."
This hymn was written by Arnulf of Louvain. He died in 1250, a very old hymn. Music was arranged by Johann Sebastian Bach. This is the 3 days of Holy Week. This is Good Friday. At the time Jesus died on his cross, around 3:00 in the afternoon, he said, "God, receive my spirit." His soul left his body. It is body was put in the tomb, and while it was in the tomb, he received a resurrected body. His body did not decay as our body, but his resurrected body still maintained his wounds, hands, feet, and side.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. It was noon, and darkness gripped all of Judea. But why? What was the strange phenomenon of darkness? Darkness so thick and so heavy that it put a restraint on all activity and brought it to a screeching halt. A darkness that was making brave men cringe in fear and cowardly men scream and flee for cover. 3 men were being crucified on Golgotha Hill that day, but so what? The Romans were always crucifying people. It almost seemed to be their national pastime. So a crucifixion wasn't that unusual. Yet never before had there been such darkness over the entire land. A darkness that would not loosen its grip, but instead seemed to be gripping the land more tightly with each passing moment. Maybe there was something different about the crucifixions on this day. Maybe Rome had overstepped her bounds and God was answering in displeasure with this heavy, choking, suffocating darkness. But if so, what was God saying? First, God was saying to the darkness that he was emphasizing the fact that Jesus was indeed his son. After the scourging was over, the crosses picked up, carried to the place of execution, the men nailed to the crosses then put upright in their place, the people began to gather as always. And they began to taunt those being crucified. But on this day, there seemed to be an unusual amount of jeering and ridicule directed at the man on the middle cross. Above his head, everyone could read his offense. It was written in Hebrew and Latin. Simply said, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." From 9 in the morning, when the execution began, until noon, when the darkness settled in, the crowd had taunted and jeered this poor victim in the middle more than anyone else. Even one of the other victims on the cross began to participate in the activity. But then the darkness settled. And when the darkness settled in, voices became suddenly silent. They became silent almost as if they realized that they had entered God. With the darkness all around, gripping all of Judea, even the religious leaders who had seemingly jeered the loudest had become silent. The religious leaders, they should have known what God was doing. They should have known that God was indeed taking action and that indeed God was not pleased. Hundreds of years before, the prophet Amos had delivered the word of the Lord to the people of Israel, predicting just such a day. Hear the words of the prophet again, as he says in the 8th chapter of his book, verses 9 and 10. "And on that day, declares the Lord God, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth in broad day. I will turn your feast into mourning, and all your songs into lamentations. I will bring sackcloth on every waist, and baldness on every head. I will make it like the morning for an only son, and the end of it like a bitter day. The word of the prophet Amos predicted hundreds of years before what was taking place, and the religious leaders were acting as if they had never read the book of the prophet Amos in their life. How could they be so ignorant? How could they not recognize this prophecy coming true right before their eyes? How could they not see this fulfillment of God's word through the prophet Amos? God had said he would darken the earth, that he would turn their feast into mourning, M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G, not mourning, M-O-R-N, mourning, crying, grieving. It was a feast of Passover, and the words of Amos were coming true right before their eyes. The Hebrew word that we translate as turn means to overthrow something. It means to overturn it, to convert it to something else, to change it, or it can mean to destroy it totally and completely altogether. That first Good Friday, God was changing, converting, overturning, overthrowing, and destroying the Passover feast from what it had been. Changing to the sacrament of the altar, the Lord's Supper, for those of us who believe in His Son, dying on that cross that first Good Friday. A new lamb was being offered up. The perfect lamb was being offered up. The only Son of God, in order to take away the sins of the world and to save the world and by himself. The religious leaders, before they were silenced by the darkness, had jeered, he could save others, can he save himself? They should have known the answer. Of course Jesus could save himself. As he said when they arrested him in the Garden of Gethsemane, after St. Peter pulled out his sword and struck the ear of the high priest's servant, after Jesus told him to put the sword away, that those who lived by the sword would die by the sword, he said to him, he said, "Do you not realize that my Father could send 12 legions of angels to protect me if I request it?" Of course Jesus could save himself. By the way, 12 legions of angels comes out to the standard Roman legion with 6,000 soldiers, so you're talking about 72,000 angels that could have come to rescue Jesus if he had so desired. But that was not his purpose. That was not why he came upon this earth. That is not why he allowed himself to be captured and handed over to evil men, to be mocked and ridiculed and beaten and crucified. No, he did it so that you and I and everyone else might have salvation. For had he saved himself, instead of going on through with the plan, then we would have no salvation. And we would have no promise of everlasting life. Jesus had to die so that those who believe in him might not perish, but have everlasting life. Darkness brings to life the words of the prophets. The festival was turned into mourning as the people panic in the darkness as God mourns. by those theologians and preachers who try to downplay the suffering of Jesus on the cross. Usually it's theologians and pastors from what we call the non-liturgical tradition. When they hear Jesus say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? They try to honeycomb it, say, oh, well, Jesus was just repeating the words of Psalm 22 to give him comfort and strength. And if you go and read Psalm 22, it starts out sounding like an appeal, my God, why have you forsaken me? But by the end of the psalm, it has a happy ending. But still there is the suffering that takes place. And it is the same with our Lord Jesus Christ when he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? It was because God had to forsake him on that cross in order to be the perfect payment for the sins that we commit. He had to be abandoned by God so that he would be the blood that washes us clean of our sin. He had to be abandoned at that moment so that when God looks at us, instead of seeing sinners in the hands of an angry God worthy of condemnation, he sees children of the Heavenly Father, heirs to the kingdom, brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. So Jesus wasn't repeating the words of Psalm 22 to comfort himself at that moment. He was repeating them because he felt the absence of his Father for the first time in his earthly ministry, as he realized he was becoming total sin for the salvation of us. Which brings us to the second message of the darkness, which is the darkness symbolizes the darkness of sin that we commit. Today, sin is often glossed over and not taken seriously. Much is due to all the excuses people give for their behavior, trying to explain their behavior away or not be held accountable for what they do. And they don't want to look at the idea of repercussions for actions that you take. Yet you are accountable. And sin does echo throughout society. You may think that what you do when you sin is no big deal. You may think that if you violate God's will or his commandments, so what? Most people won't even know about it, and it's not going to cause the stock market to crash, or war to be declared, or the oceans to rise, or the mountains to fall. But there are repercussions. No one, you think, will be worse off because of what you've done. Yet the darkness of Good Friday demonstrates that sin covers all of society. When you violate God's will, all suffer because of the ramifications that happen. A person is murdered. It doesn't just affect the family of the victim. It affects the members of the police force and the detectives that have to investigate that murder. It affects the DA or assistant DA who has to bring the offender to trial. It affects the family of the offender. The one who committed the crime, they are affected. And the ramifications go ripple through the extended family. And depending on who is murdered, their murder can also have effects on a certain area of society where they were a strong influence, such as in the field of science or math or education or medicine or space or something where they were an important part of finding new cures or new inventions or whatever. A person that steals, shoplifts, said, oh, it's no big deal, the store will let it off. No, the store doesn't write it off. Having had a wife who spent 25 years in retail management, when you shoplift, the store raises the price to cover what was shoplifted. When the boys and Jane and I moved up to Little Griffith, Indiana, we ran into something I'd never heard of before. I'm not sure it's still legal. I think maybe it was found in the world illegal, but when we lived in Northwest Indiana, it was legal. It was called redlining. Because Griffith bordered Gary and Hammond, Indiana, which had terrible car theft crimes, and because we were close to East Chicago, which was in Indiana, and close to Whiting and Hobart, where stealing cars was a problem. If you lived within this certain so many miles, they drew a red line, the insurance companies. And if you lived north of that line, which we did, your insurance was doubled. If you live south of that line, you pay the normal price premium for car insurance that most other people do. So you can imagine our shop when we had to get insurance in Indiana because what we had in Kentucky would not work. And it was twice what we had been paying in Kentucky, all because of risk. All because somebody stole a car and thought it wouldn't affect anybody but the person he stole it from. That's what sin does. It redlines. It has effects that go far beyond the person who does the sin and the person who is sinned against. Sin suffocates, sin destroys, sin turns society upside down. The darkness was gripping Judea because sin that Jesus was paying an ultimate price for. And third, the darkness symbolizes the withdrawal of God's light from the sinner. Because God is holy, because God is perfect, because God is God, he cannot be in the presence of sin. He cannot tolerate sin, not even a little bitty sin. To God, sin is sin. Doesn't matter what it is. And so he cannot tolerate it. He cannot be in the presence of it. And so on the cross, Jesus became that sin for us so that God had to remove himself, as I mentioned earlier, from his son, so that payment could be made. This action of God removing himself from those he chose is not something that we did not see God do before. In the Old Testament, we have a number of examples where God chose someone and then removed his favor from them and they did not follow through. Samson. God chose Samson to free the Hebrew children from the Philistines' oppression. Samson did okay for a while, but then he made that sin of telling Delilah the source of his strength. His hair was cut, and God took away his strength. Saul, the first king of Israel, would not do what God asked. He would not do what God commanded. And so God withdrew his favor from Saul and placed it on a former shepherd boy named David. And from David came the lineage of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So God has to withdraw himself from sin. He cannot be in the presence of it. So on that first Good Friday, God withdraws the light not just from Golgotha, but throughout all Judea, so that Jesus' death might be that final and perfect payment for the sins that we commit, for the sins of the entire world. No more sheep, no more lambs, no more goats, no more calves, no more bulls would be offered on the altar of the temple for the sins of the people, because a perfect lamb was slaughtered on the cross of Calvary to overcome the darkness, to conquer sin, to keep the light of God in your heart. Come to the cross of Christ and lay your burdens down. Come to the cross and give up your pride, your jealousy, your arrogance, your self-centeredness, your selfish ambitions, and let the blood of Christ cleanse you and make you as pure as freshly fallen snow. Come to the cross, and through faith in what Jesus Christ has done, overcome the darkness of life. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now sing, Alas, and Didn't I Say We Bleed, hymn number 337, in the back of your worship.
This hymn for Good Friday was written by Isaac Watts. He was born in 1674, the father of English hymnology. He felt he could write better hymns, more spirited hymns than the psalms that were sung. He told his father that, and his father challenged him to write hymns. He wrote one a week. This is one of his hymns, Alas, and Did My Savior Bleed. And remember that Jesus died on the cross to save us from sins. Then he commended his spirit to God. His soul left his body. His dead body was in the tomb. And then later, his resurrected body arose from the tomb.
By your Holy Spirit, guide the church and gather it throughout the world. Help it to persevere in faith, proclaim your name, and bring the good news of salvation in Christ to all people. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for all bishops and pastors, for all servants of the church, and for all the people of God. Almighty and eternal God, your Spirit guides the church and makes it holy. Strengthen and uphold our bishops, pastors, other ministers, and lay leaders. Keep them in health and safety for the good of the church, and help each of us in our various vocations to do faithfully the work to which you have called us. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those preparing for baptism. Almighty and eternal God, you continue to bless the church, increase the faith and understanding of those preparing for baptism. Give them new birth as your children, and keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for our sisters and brothers who share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, you give your church unity, look with favor on all who follow Jesus, your Son. Make all baptized one in the fullness of faith, and keep us united in the fellowship of love. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for the Jewish people, the first to hear the word of God. Almighty and eternal God, long ago you gave your promise to Abraham and your teachings to Moses. Hear our prayers that the people you called and elected as your own may receive the fulfillment of the covenant's promise. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for those who do not share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, gather into your embrace all those who call out to you under different names. Bring an end to interreligious strife and make us more faithful witness of the love made known to us in your Son. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those who do not believe in God. Almighty and eternal God, you created humanity so that all may long to know you and find peace in you. Grant that all may recognize the signs of your love and grace in the world and in the lives of Christians, and gladly acknowledge you as the one true God. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for God's creation. Almighty and eternal God, you are the creator of a magnificent universe. Hold all the worlds in the arms of your care and bring all things to fulfillment in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for those who serve in public office. Almighty and eternal God, you are the champion of the poor and oppressed. In your goodness, give wisdom to those in authority, so that all people may enjoy justice, peace, freedom, and a share in the goodness of your creation. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for those in need. Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and you encourage to those who have lost heart. Heal the sick, comfort the dying, give safety to travelers, free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and deliver your world from falsehood, hunger, and disease. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in any trouble, that they may have the joy of receiving your help in their need. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Finally, let us pray for all those things for which our Lord would have us ask. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the Savior of the whole world. Come, let us worship Him. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the Savior of the whole world. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the Savior of the whole world.
Holy God, holy, mighty, holy, Lord, have mercy on us.
O my people, O my church, What more could I have done for you? Answer me. I granted you into my people Israel, but you made them scapegoats for your own guilt, and you've prepared a cross for your sake.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
O my people, O my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I came to you in the least of your brothers and sisters, but I was hungry and you gave me no food, thirsty and you gave me no drink, a stranger and you did not welcome me, naked and you did not clothe me, sick and in prison and you did not visit me, and you have prepared a cross for your sake.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you. By your holy cross, you have redeemed the world. We will now sing Our Holy Jesus, hymn number 349, in the back of the church.
Herman, German hymn writer who lived 1585 to 1647. Very old hymn. 3 days, last 3 days of Holy Week. This is Good Friday, the 14th of February, commemorating Jesus' death on the cross.
Thank you.
This concludes the Good Friday service.